call Travis.
The cordial.
Good morning, Councilor Dodson.
There's something wrong with that one.
There is.
It's working. Everything's being recorded.
Yep.
You're all
ready.
We're good. Good morning. I'd like to call this meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works for Tuesday, February 10th, to order. I'd like to introduce members of my committee: Councillor Dodson, Councillor Gilroy, Councillor Sharma, and members of the administration. Clerk Watt, and administration who's here. All right. I'd like to ask for a motion to approve minutes of meeting held on January 16th, 2015. So moved.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Now, are there any delegations to come forward?
Yes, Madam Clerk, we have Madam Counselor, we have delegations in front of you here.
All right. Perfect. All right. Councillor Edie Minarski Ward to be heard with respect to the snow clearing review, report 3. Morning,
Councilor Lady. Gotta watch out. I've been having lots of accidents last week. So far, I'm okay.
No.
Little one there. Thank you, Chairperson Lukes, for allowing me to come to speak today, councillors. Actually, this motion in terms of a snow clearing review, it is quite detailed. It lists out a different number of ways of measuring the and examining to measure how our snow clearing is doing within the city of Winnipeg, and it does call on looking at, you know, what's the value for money we're getting in terms of clearing on both sides, on our public side and on our on the private side, private contractors. So I really don't have a lot to say about it. If you want to ask some questions, you could. But and I understand that the administration, and this is one of the big things that I think a lot of us coming out of the last election don't understand, is that our administration isn't really all that top heavy, but it's usually middle management and different people who will conduct and do these reviews. So I understand that it's going to be difficult to find the people power to do this review, but it is a necessary one. I note that the auditor is looking for the value for money in our other, some of our other private service areas. So I think that that's a good thing, because really we need to know, well, what I can tell you, since I've been involved at City, I know that the services line in many of the budgets of all these departments have continually rise due to our contracting out and that sort of thing. So. Really, if those things are rising, we really do need to measure them. It's very, very important to do that. And so on the snow clearing issue, definitely in my ward, we have a number of complaints. And it's not like we don't get complaints with the parts in my ward that are delivered by our own city services, but it seems to me that we get a lot more complaints on the streets that we as a city are not plowing directly. We have streets inspectors out there trying to stay on top of the private contractors doing their appropriate jobs. There's been lots of damage, of course. The odd thing in West Kildonan, it's really interesting, is that because of the way they used to bake their curbs, when they rip out curbs in West Kildonan, they don't get replaced because they don't want to restore a curb to the old way of doing things, not meeting the higher standard that we had in the city of Winnipeg. It's kind of a legacy from us becoming a citywide together with other cities coming in. So there are those difficulties. The last thing I would point out in terms of doing this evaluation, and I'll see fit to your wisdom as to when you might expect a report or whatever. It doesn't really say in this request when we would expect to see a report. So we need to keep that in context. But One of the things I can say, and if it makes sense that we take over some of the areas for snow plowing, there's always this thing where they'll say, well, how much is it going to cost for us to buy the extra equipment? Now, I want to point out something to you. Part of the reason the private contractors have said they don't do as good a job is that they say they can't afford to buy the equipment. So what we did it was either June, July, or September, is there was a proposal that came from the city regarding snow clearing. And what it did was it recommended shrinking some zones. And it recommended that we enter into longer-term contracts, probably for more, so the private sector could buy more equipment, appropriate equipment. So if we're willing to pay that fee to the private sector, then I don't see any reason, when you get to the last point in this motion, no reason at all for us to consider investing to achieve efficiency and better quality value for money. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Councillor Eady, I have a question for you. I'm looking over your points that you have here, and I'm just wondering maybe if you could explain to the committee here how you think that we should determine the costs with private companies and the health and safety data with private companies. I mean, that information, they're private companies. That's hard. How are we going to get that? Like, how's administration going to go and get that? I completely hear you, and I agree with value for money. But I'm just wondering how, in some of these cases, some of your bullets here, how we're going to get that information.
It would be my expectation that they try to fulfill and examine each area there. If there is an inability to get that kind of information from the private sector, I'm not sure if you can get a general report from the workers' compensation or not, but when you talk about health and safety, those are issues to consider. Although if you have a general contractor and they're subcontracting out and each person is treated as a separate employee, yeah, it would be very hard to measure. But we definitely know, this is a very important point, Chairperson Lukes, is that when you have it within the city, we can measure that. Yes.
All right. So,
okay.
Thank you. Thank All you. Right. Any questions, or do any members have questions? No questions? Okay. Thank you, Councillor. Thank you very much. All right. Now we have for a delegation, we've got Councillor Allard, St. Boniface Ward, to be heard with respect to the review of transit service, Sage Creek, Rollwood Island Lakes, and South Park, Southland Park. Councillor Allard, good morning.
Hello, Councillor Lukes. Not long time no see. We were in community committee, a rail community committee yesterday for those who weren't there. This is a very simple motion, I think. This is about the southern part of St. Boniface, so the communities of Sage Creek, Royalwood, Island Lakes, and Southland Parks. Southland Park. While going door to door during the campaign, I heard many people at the door talk about transit service, and I do understand the situation we have in terms of budgets and buses, and I have been in communication with transit regarding some of these questions and regarding some of the service. So essentially it's asking to review the service in those areas, because when you go to the door, when you talk to residents, they clearly would like to see more access to transit services in those areas. And I do realize it's a tough budget, but what I hear at the door is, you know, I pay among the highest taxes in Winnipeg. These are generally developments that where the property tax rolls are pretty significant. So people do expect a certain level of service, and in some cases they don't feel that they're getting it. So that's why I'm bringing forward this motion. I would also like to, if the committee is agreeable, I'd like to add Waterside Estates to the list of communities. It's a new community, and they've expressed similar concerns. So, and that was in a meeting I had since the authoring of this original motion.
Okay. All right. I'm sure there's a process that we have to do that.
Yeah, you could just amend the recommendation and add that.
We'll amend it. Are we in favor of amending it?
We'll do that when we get to the item, Councillor.
Okay, great, okay. All right.
So I understand you have a similar motion on the books, Councillor Lukes.
I do have a similar motion. And Councillor Sharma's had a similar motion that came through last year, and when Mr. Wardrop comes up to speak to these, I think we'll get a little more thorough understanding of the big picture of transit going forward. I'm thrilled that we're hearing more need for transit in these suburban communities. I hear you completely, because I heard the same thing with Waverly West, so I hear your concerns. I'm wondering if other members of council have any questions of this committee? Councillor Sharma?
Thanks very much, Councillor Lard, for coming forward on this. Is there any service in these neighborhoods, or are they looking for enhanced service?
They're generally looking for enhanced service, but I guess what I'm asking from the administration is to review, you know, what's happening there and what would be possible in terms of enhanced service.
But there is some service, at least in the area?
There's some service. Sometimes you need to go, you know, towards the end of the community to get it, but there is some service.
Sure, which is probably way past the 400-meter textbook rule, right?
I would imagine, yeah.
Look at these issues. Thank you.
Yeah, and really, I mean, I had what I would qualify as I guess a surprising level of this issue coming up at the door. It really is. You might not expect it going in, but knocking on those doors, people were really talking about transit, and I was happy to hear it. And I mean, at the same time, happy to speak on their behalf.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions of the committee members? Super. Thank you. Thanks very much. All right. Councillor Mays, St. Vital Ward, to be heard with respect to Gay Street Crosswalk. See Report 4.
Okay, I'm actually, thank you, Madam Chair. I think I actually registered on three things, but I'll be brief. My thanks to Councillor Eadie for addressing the snow clearing issue, which, remember, I had somebody from out of town helping me on my campaign this time, and after a couple of days, I could hear them talking about Zone J to people at the door. So you realize this comes up enough that they were hearing me talk about Zone J. So snow clearing continuing to be a big issue, but I'll let Councillor Eadie take the lead on that. The three things I had registered on, number four should probably really be named Carrier Street Crosswalk. This is at the extreme north end of my ward. The boundary street with Councillor Allard is Carrier. But the proposal here was to possibly remove the existing paint and signs crosswalk at Gay, which had been a recommendation of Public Works a couple of years ago, and replace it with a lighted corridor at Carrier, which is a few blocks north where there is a bus stop. There's a long stretch of St. Mary's Road where there's no controlled crossing, and so that seemed like a reasonable compromise. At the risk of being accused of taking a crosswalk out of my ward and having one added into St. Boniface, it is right at the boundary street. So we just wanted to get a study done of that by the administration. Number six is at the extreme other end of my ward, south of the perimeter, south of Councillor Allard's ward. The Prairie Grove area is in the south of perimeter area where there is no transit and thus no handy transit. Always a good issue. Councillor Sharma will be familiar with debates we've had here before about if you don't have transit, you don't get handy transit either. So it's a great thing when you get the transit service added in. But Prairie Grove, the request here is a traffic study. If this looks vaguely familiar, it's because you had it on your December agenda and it was simply received for information. And I've talked to the chair about this, saying all I want is a study done by Brad Satcher's group, by Louis Escobar. This Prairie Grove area, south of the perimeter, some concerned residents, and there are no sidewalks down there. And they're concerned that with 70 kilometer an hour for the through street, that was simply too fast for kids in the area. So just wanted to get an assessment of that. And at the other end of the ward, on the far west side of the ward, is another item, the south of Aldgate recreational study. This is, members of the media can simply retweet what they tweeted about 6 weeks ago when this ended up at the PCS committee, which it should have ended up here all along. This is simply a request from Councillor Lukes, and I thank you for your support on this. Boundary between my ward and Councillor Lukes goes down the middle of this area. It's a 6-acre green space. It's a road right-of-way, so it's not a park. It's a road right-of-way. Dakota someday will get punched all the way through to the perimeter, but the province wants it to be an overpass, so very expensive. There's a neighborhood going around there on both sides, east and west. lot of young families. So we've said, look, for the next 10, 15, 20 years, while it's still a green space, let's have a study done. Can we do, I thought maybe we could do some sort of toboggan berms. The administration thought maybe some sort of bike berms. Councillor Luke's, to her credit, talked about community gardens. We don't know exactly what, but at least if we can get a study of temporary uses there, not permanent, because that might block the roadway, but just temporary use. Maybe it's community gardens, maybe it's something else. We can use the space for the families and not just have it sit there for 20 years as mowed 6-acre green space while all the families are calling us, asking for more opportunities for recreation or to use the space. So
okay.
I suspect we'll hear more from Waterside Estates, Madam Chair, as Councillor Allard seems to become the champion for that area. So commendations to him. But those are my three points today.
Okay. Are there any questions on any of them? I have no questions. Do any members here have any questions of Councillor Mays?
Makes good sense.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. And Councillor Wyatt wanted to be here. We don't see him here, so we'll move on. All right. In delegation, Mike Davidson, president of QB Local 500, to be heard in support of snow clearing review. Mr. Davidson. Hello. Nice to meet you. Thank you. Thanks.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's nice to see everyone. And when I was driving here today, the streets were a little bit slick, and I thought here I'm going to be speaking to the issue of snow clearing, and it's traffic's near a stall, so that must be an omen of some type. I'm not sure how that fits in, but it took me a little while to get here this morning. No fault of the equipment. That's Mother Nature speaking. Local 500 always appreciates the opportunity to come to City Hall to express its points of view. And I want to start off first by commending Councillor Eady for moving this motion and Mays on seconding it. I looked through the motion and on the results, I think there's merit to a number of these that do need to be explored. And there's no doubt that Winnipeggers are concerned about snow clearing and the quality of service that we've had. There's been a lot of controversy through the media and expressed, I guess, the last couple of years. Last year we had a very harsh winter. Well, I think the harshest winter since 1896. So this morning, my remarks today will focus on the need for the city to review its snow clearing practices, including a review of the continued use of contracted snow clearing services. And Winnipeggers, we know, they're like Canadians right across the country. They want timely and effective snow clearing services, regardless of weather conditions. Sometimes that's difficult to do. As I said last year, we had a pretty harsh winter, what we witnessed last year. And even the firefighters union last year, they commented and expressed their deep concern that failed snow clearing in some situations can result in serious safety issues for Winnipeggers. And in addition, MPI reported drastic increases in collision and accidents due to poor road conditions. So there's a cost attributed to that too, that at the end of the day, the citizens of Winnipeg, they ante up there by paying more on their insurance. And I'm sure many of you read in depth the Winnipeg Free Press story by Dan Lett last January 25th, titled Epic Fail or Perfect Storm, which he gave somewhat of a fair analysis of how the weather events of December and early January of last year unfolded. And there are certain aspects of his articles that merit further discussion in my view. Lett's article references the fact that one of the challenges facing our snow clearing services is the fact that there is simply not enough data to make any sort of analysis related to the cost or the quality comparators between the private contractors and the public operators. And this is something that we should all be concerned about. And Local 500 is in receipt of a Freedom of Information request that we submitted in the fall of 2013. And I'll read it here. What we requested was copies of any reports or analysis comparing in-house snow removal versus contracted out snow removal. The time frame for this request was from January 1st to 1998 to the present. So we received the following response. The Public Works Department does not maintain performance / productivity measures on private versus in-house snow clearing contracts, primarily due to the way in which operations are designed. The city has 9 snow clearing contracts that are all-inclusive, and they're bidding and paid out on event basis over the entire area. By contrast, the internal services are paid on an hourly basis with no start and end measurement for the event. So it continues, the differing approaches to service delivery prevent the type of comparative analysis or reporting requested. So the fact is, the city is, despite snow clearing services being a core service, has not even attempted to review or compare contracted versus in-house snow clearing. They say it's not possible. So I guess that's a huge concern to us, given the length of time. Other cities across Canada have in-house snow removal, and other cities have contracted out snow removal, but this city hasn't reviewed internally or externally these two service delivery models in nearly 17 years. So our concern there is 17 years have gone by, and we have no cost analysis between public and private. We question that why that took place. And on December 17, 2013, Local 500 provided a brief to City Council on the operating budget. And at this presentation, we noted that the operational review of Public Works released in June 2013 highlighted the fact that snow removal, which is 80% contracted out, is one area of Public Works where cost exceeds those of peer cities. The report further recommends that the city review the cost of contracted versus in-house snow and ice services. So in our view there, 80% of the service is contracted out. One could conclude that have we lost public control of our snow and ice clearing? I'm not saying at this point in time that other cities have achieved contracting out to that percentage, but we do question that 80% is a lot of work contracted out where we perhaps should have more control over a core service like snow and ice removal. So that's something to be considered, especially a city that receives the amount of snow that we're capable of getting. I think last year that highlighted that. And even the city's finance chair at that time said he was exploring if a switch to a more public service snow removal could save money. Local 500 continues to maintain that true cost savings can be found by reining in these snow clearing contracts and bringing the service back in-house, or at the very least, having a comparative. We have done that before. 80%, we feel that model simply does not work for the city. Our FIPA, in addition to the recommendations of the Public Works Review, provides that not only does this city fail to act on its own reports, but has failed to act responsibly to review, analyze, and present alternatives to the contracted services that make up 80% of our snow clearing. So we would strongly urge this committee, as well as council, to take seriously our position that snow clearing in Winnipeg should be phased back in-house. And you know, other things to note as well is back in the old days when we had a model where we had a good mix of public force, we could direct our public force no matter what. And I'm not saying that doesn't necessarily happen now, but when you have a hands-on approach, when you have your employees doing that, many of these employees were fixing the streets. They know the back lanes. They know how things twist and turn. It was mentioned about damage. I don't even know if we have a cost analysis to compare where we are with damages. We heard Councillor Edie mention curb replacement. We have property damage. We have a number of things. No fault to a lot of operators, because a lot of these operators in the private sector, as I've said, the conditions of the roads, the back lanes. These are things that we fixed, we repaired. We used to have a cement and asphalt plant. So the people that were working on construction, they also knew the areas, they knew the streets, they knew the back lanes. And these costs, in our view, in terms of damages, are probably very high, but we've never had a cost analysis. At the very least, I would urge this committee to get those numbers, get that data, so that a decision can be made and moving forward on a plan. How can we best serve the citizens of Winnipeg? How can we best direct our workforce if we have a year that we had last year, where we have more control over what we're doing? 9 separate contracts, a city our size, I question that. I mean, is that going to make it competitive, or is that going to make it difficult to manage? Who's checking up on the work that's being currently done? Our workforce goes out there. We have foremen that keep track of what's being done, what's not being done. You have to administer these contracts. And it was noted, too, a lot of the equipment that the contractors have is old, worn-out equipment that the city once had that they've picked up. So I think there's a lot of, I think that there's a lot of information that has to come forward. And I do believe this committee sort of inherited something that you've been handed. And I do think that to get all the information and then make a recommendation would be very important to do. That's my presentation this morning.
Okay, thank you. Those were very good points you brought forward. We're going to have Mr. Satcher up here speaking to this, I think, at one point where he can maybe make some comments. Do I have any questions? Does anyone have any questions?
Actually, it's a very good points that you made up, that there's no real data, so we don't know if we can save money.
Well, that's why 17 years with no cost analysis, public versus private, I agree with you, Councillor.
Yep.
That's why we need that information, and that's why I sort of cited a Mr. Letts story, because I believe at that time he hit the nail right on the hair, right on the head. How do you do a cost analysis if you don't have the data? Mm-hmm. Yeah. 17 years have gone, that's a long time. You have to get that information before you can make a comprehensive decision on which direction you're going to go. I mean, the citizens of Winnipeg, they want prompt service, they want value for their money, they want to know that a core service, because we live in Winnipeg, I mean, we get a lot of snow, that service is going to be done in a timely fashion, and it's going to be in line with all the other factors in place. Private sectors, who else can do it? They want to know that. You know, it's like when we're doing a road construction, they want cost in line, but they want the work to be effective. They want the service to be good, right? So in order to do that, the only way that I can see is we've waited. I know last year we made a presentation too, and we wanted that information to come forward so that you, as the leadership of the City of Winnipeg, can make a decision. You can't make a decision if you don't have the data. So.
Good point.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Did Councillor Wyatt show up? No?
So I'm not walking up.
Pardon me?
He was walking into the building.
Well, he's not here. Okay. Okay. So now we'll move into the reports. Report number one, review of transit service, Bridgewater Forest, Bridgewater Lakes, and South Point. Mr. Wardrop, would you like to come up and, I don't know, I guess we have to speak to these separately or to, there? I mean, they're two in the same. One, yeah. And two are one and the same. Pardon me?
Move them separately.
We'll move them separately, yeah. But you can. So, Mr. Wardrop, this is an issue many of us heard when we were knocking on doors, and if you could maybe just highlight to members of council here and people in the room what the process is that you go about in determining what areas receive extended transit or new transit services.
Well, we regularly, as a department, we regularly review our transit service, the demands, and the basically the urban footprint within the city of Winnipeg as a whole, and look to as best possible, maintain our 400-meter walking distance to the nearest stop criteria, and to provide a service over that. Usually when new developments come along, when the area of approximately 250 homes or so get built out, we start looking at implementing a service peak day, peak morning, afternoon service type level basis. As developments build out and more and more people populate an area, we look at providing more comprehensive week-long full-day service as much as we can. Of course, the problem we are faced with is the city is growing at a rate of about 1.5% per year. Transit demand is growing in the area of 2.5 to 3% per year. So we're seeing not only the organic growth of the city, but we're seeing an increase in market share in terms of demand of transit itself. Unfortunately, we're not, the fleet itself and resourced itself aren't going at a rate to adequately to address some of that demand. So areas that certainly you know, we would like to look at implementing new service on become more difficult as we're faced with resource constraints.
Yeah, any questions?
We need to find a way to bridge that gap. There's new developments coming online.
Absolutely.
250 houses we're talking about. I mean, that's tenfold in my ward, more than that in some cases.
Absolutely, Councillor. And it's really not just an issue of servicing the larger footprint of the city, the geographic footprint of the city itself. It's the overall increase in demand. So even as we have already developed areas and increased infill development that is occurring within those areas, we've got increased ridership that's occurring, and we're seeing that in terms of overcrowding and pass-ups that's occurring on the regular service. So we're stretched to provide enough regular service to new developments, but even providing adequate service to existing developments. We had, as you're aware, we had we received tremendous value when we purchased 20 articulated buses halfway through their economic life for a total of $1 million, and basically at a 90% discount. We had 20 articulated buses which have the carrying capacity of effectively 30 buses, and that's helped stem some of the demand that we've seen in some parts of the city in terms of it dealing with some of the overcrowding. But it's a temporary measure. It was a one-time opportunity that we managed to grab and take advantage of, and has worked out very well for us to deal with some of the peak demand issues that we're faced with. But in terms of supplying the regular demands to some of the new developments, there's no question that we are taxed.
So it's a balance. It's finding the balance. I'm thrilled that there's more desire for transit, and it's public transit, and there's great value in public transit, but it's the balance again. And it's a big challenge because the city's growing, and I mean, in Waverly West, there's no transit in some areas.
Yeah.
Same with Sage Creek, we want enhanced.
My concern is that the positive trend that we've seen in terms of the growing demand of transit, we're going to hit a point where we're going to start to constrain that, because
I think we are because
we're going to get to a point where the increased demand for transit people are going to become frustrated. They're going to become frustrated mm-hmm. through overcrowding. They're going to become frustrated through pass-ups, and they're going to be frustrated by the lack of accessibility and availability of the service. And so we will no longer be in a situation where we're growing at a rate greater than the growth of the city, and in fact relieving some of the congestion that would otherwise be occurring, but in fact we may be at a point where we slow to the growth of the rate of the city, or perhaps even stagnate in terms of our growth, and hopefully not resume our trend of reduced transit demand that we had seen a long-term reduction in our trend over the years in the past. It's that we've managed to reverse, and we have to be cautious not to lose that momentum.
And I mean, it's great that we're doing rapid transit, but we have to have these feeders, we have to have these community feeders to get to it. So I hear you. Okay. Yep. Any other questions or comments on this?
So referral to the administration on this item.
Okay. All in favor? Sorry.
May I ask, is it possible to request 120 days?
120 days. We've got 60 days here, and we've got 90 days. Sure, we'll do that.
I think that's fine, yeah. There's no urgency since we're wrapping up budget process now.
You're amending it, Councilor Sharma, to 120 days from 60?
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. And then
question.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And then we'll do item number 2, and we'll make an amendment to that.
To add Waterside Estates.
Waterside Estates.
Okay.
And we'll amend it to 120 days also. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Thank you.
Okay. Item number 3, snow clearing review. Mr. Satcher, are you available? Are you here? Would you like to come up and speak to this?
Good morning.
So we heard Mr. Davidson speak very well on cost-benefit analysis between private and public. We understand the challenges of getting information from private companies. It is a core service, snow and ice removal. We are a winter city. Maybe you could speak to some of the comments that were brought up this morning.
Sure. First of all, it was characterized as we don't have data and we don't know anything about costs. We know a lot about the costs. Those nine private contractor contracts are tendered, which means there's a competitive tension induced into that process, which makes it a competitive process. So by all of our able staff and their analysis, we're quite confident that we get good value from those contracts. The other thing that I want to be very clear on is that those contractors aren't just there wandering around doing whatever they want when they want. All of our contracts are managed and inspected, not only when the contracts are set, but while the operations are ongoing, by our internal staff. The contractors take direction from us in what they do when they start their operations. The city sets out when those will start, when we're going to start a P1 operation, when we're going to do the P2s, and if we're doing a P3, the residential streets. That's all decided by the city. The contractors are then held to standards while they're doing that, in keeping with the council-approved policy. And from time to time, the council or the contractors will pay fines or be charged when they don't meet those requirements. And that's because we have people out inspecting. The reason why there isn't specific data on that comparison is because of the way that we're set up, and that we the vast majority of what we do is set out with private contracts. The other way that we use private contractors is, aside from set area contracts, is a thing called bid hourly. And we have standards in that bid hourly that the contractors have to meet. The equipment has to be new or like new, because we're interested in the reliability. We don't want to hire someone with a piece of equipment that isn't going to be able to meet our needs. And there is a competitive tension as well. The contractors have to have good prices and good equipment. And again, that those the activities that they undertake under the hourly work is directly under the control and direction of our staff. So we don't have contractors wandering around out there doing whatever they want. On a morning like this, where we're starting to get snow and we're addressing it with salting right now because the conditions allow on our major routes, that's being done by our internal forces. We have the spreading equipment, salting and sanding, and the capacity at this time to do that. And as the event unfolds, and it is yet to be seen how that's going to happen, we will then be getting into the contracted work if and when required, and based on the forecast, that's what we're expecting later on in the day. and again, that work that's done out there is under the supervision and inspection of our forces. We haven't looked specifically at this before. We're happy to do it. The KPMG report, when they talked about the cost of our services, what they were focusing on was the award-winning high level of service that we provide. You know, bare pavement on the residential streets was something that they focused on and actually recommended that we review that to see if we were getting good value there, and we're in the process of doing that. We have to report back. I believe it's in June, and so it wasn't a mystery to them. They actually came out and watched the residential plowing operation. They watched our other operations. They had lots of data from us
to take a look at our operations, and they were charged with trying to find efficiencies in how we do things. And what they came up with was, take a look at how you're doing the residential plowing operation, because we think that standard is perhaps too high.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and that's, this is, it is in the KPMG report that's online, okay?
Yeah. So I believe we have a very good service. We have a lot of folks, both private and certainly internally, who dedicate their life to this. And they're the people who are out in the middle of the night, no one else is around, keeping the streets safe and clear, so that when we're driving on them, you know, they're as safe as possible, and that our economy is able to move. And I think we do a very good job of that. We did have problems with a couple of the contracted areas that were highly publicized and talked about last year during the incredible winter that we had. In particular, there was a lot of focus on a Zone J in the St. Patel area, and we did have a problem there. And so the solution there was to divide that up, which we've done with the latest contract renewals. And we're confident that we're not going to see those kinds of problems again. So we work very closely with the contractors. We work very closely with each other internally. And from my perspective, I think we do a very good job. You know, other cities look to us and ask how we're doing things. Edmonton right now, they have a process where on the residential streets they do a thing they refer to as essentially blading, which is in essence what the KPMG folks were telling us to look at. They have different standards for windrow clearing, you know, the different heights of when the resident is responsible up to versus what we do. Those kinds of things vary from city to city, but in terms of the snow clearing program, I think we do a very good job. And we're happy to look at what we've been asked to look at here. I do note that the majority of this was looked at in the KPMG report, so we'll have that information and get any new data that we need to compile. We have reams of data on costs. It just hasn't been applied to this particular analysis, and we'll be happy to do that.
Great. Okay.
Cool.
Any questions? Councilor Sharma?
Brad, could you update us as to where we're at with the current contracts? When do they expire?
They expired some time ago, and last fall we entered into new contracts with 3-year contracts with renewal to potentially extend another year if it's working for us.
Just at the beginning of a new renewal.
So maybe to address Mr. Davidson's comments about the 80% and 20% and the cost there. I mean, the facilities that we have right now, do we just redid the yards, right? Do you feel that the 80 and 20% ratio, I mean, obviously you feel it's working because...
Well, the ratio that we have and the way we approach snow clearing right now, it evolved over time. Significant changes were made after the 86 storm because it essentially shut the city down for a couple of days. And so things were changed. For instance, we now use truck plows primarily during the event to keep the roads clear. And we do that with contracted resources. And what it means is that when the event ends, we've already got to jump on things while we've been doing whatever we can to keep the keep everything open while the snow was falling. The number or the sheer volume of equipment. You know, when we have an all-out plowing operation going on, when we include the sidewalk sanders, of which 50% are private sector, 50% are internal, when we include all the loaders and all the graders and all the equipment, we've got 300 to 400 pieces of equipment out there at any one time. If we were to build facilities that could house that equipment when they're not needed, all of the spreaders, all of the graders, all of the plows, all those, all that equipment, the facilities would be taxed the way they are right now. But that doesn't mean that you know, it's not possible. We'll do the analysis. We'll look at all of those at those issues. As I said, knowing you know, the competitive nature of the contracting in terms of value, knowing the good work that our own internal staff do and how hard they work alongside the contractors and do great work. I think you know, the fact that the KPMG report really was focusing on how much we spend delivering our standard of snow clearing policy. We have been quite confident that we've got a good balance. Like I said, we're happy to look at it with the specific goal of comparing one against the other, and ensuring that what we believe we know through this specific analysis can be demonstrated.
Okay. Do you think June is a fair amount of time, by June, that you could get back to us? So
we'll do everything we can to get back to the June meeting.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, I think you covered it pretty good. If he's going to do the analysis, then we'll wait and see.
Okay. All right. Could we have someone move this, please? Mm-hmm. Councillor Gilroy will move this. All in favor?
Sorry, Councillor, you want to put timeline of June
on there?
I'm sorry,
yes, June, yeah. June, yes. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay. Now, I think we need to suspend the rules for Councillor Wyatt. Are you here for incoming delegation? Do you want
We met on Friday, as you know.
Yes.
Madam Chair, is there, I can speak again to it.
Well, we all heard it, so.
Yeah, so.
No, I just had a note here that you were going to appear in
Delhi. An old note. So,
all right,
yeah,
okay.
Sorry about that.
No problem, okay. Okay, all right. All right, so now we'll move on to item number 4, Gay Street Crosswalk. Does anyone need any further explanation from Mr. Satcher on this?
No.
If not, someone could move it.
I'll move it.
Okay. Councillor Gilroy? All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Item number 5, installation of four-way stops in the Transcona ward. Mr. Satcher. Oh.
Yeah, if. I'm looking at these, and Councillor Wyatt did a little bit of a discussion on this, and these stop signs don't necessarily warrant it, but when you look at them individually, an example would be the Edmund Gale Drive and Ravenhurst Street. I still think we should have stop signs there.
Maybe, Mr. Satcher, could you go into detail maybe on the value of, or a bit about warrants and why they're there and the reasoning behind a warrant?
Well, there are there are established standards in the traffic engineering world where we look at warrants for stop conditions. Stop signs are a traffic control device. That's just the reality of it. There are a lot of different types of traffic controls, everything from signing on up to signals, and then of course the infrastructure moves into grade separations and those types of things. With respect to this particular location, Edmund Gale Drive and Ravenhurst Street, we gathered data at the location. We applied the warrant analysis to it, And as you can see, the at the bottom of the table there, we use a highest 8-hour period. And the total approaching, so it reflects, you know, the number of cars, trucks, buses, all of the different vehicles, all the modes that enter the intersection, is about 75% of the warrant. It certainly is, you know, it's over 3,000, so it's not insignificant. But again, when we look at the warrants for a always stop condition, that's the threshold that we use. And we also look at the approaching volume on the lower volume road. That warrant is 1,600 approaches, and in this situation, there's a little over half of the warrant. So certainly it isn't significant, but it did not meet the warrant. We also look at, as part of the analysis, data that we have available to us in terms of right angle collisions and or opposing left with opposing through collisions. And the warrant is 9 collisions of this type. The data that we have indicated that there were 3. So it doesn't meet the warrant, so our recommendation was not to proceed with always stop at this time.
So how close does it have to meet the warrant, or is it like, what sort of, you know, like, is it with 50 within the warrant, or when do you decide?
Like, I think the closest one here, 2 of them are half the warrant, and the closest one here is 1,000 or so.
So are you saying it has to meet the warrant?
We use the not insignificant engineering expertise that we have here in the city. We've got some of the best traffic engineers in the country that work for us, and we're lucky to have them. They look at the warrant, they look at the collision history, and then they go and they spend a lot of time just looking at the intersection and trying to get a qualitative sense of what's going on as much as a quantitative. The warrant is part of it. If there are other circumstances that strike the engineer or the technologist who's looking at the intersection, we may recommend that always stop would be appropriate, even though it may not strictly meet the warrant. So we use engineering judgment as well, taking other factors into context. It's at the end of the day, it's always about the safety of the pedestrians using the intersection, safety of the motorists using the intersection, and at the same time trying to use some established standards as the measure of when to act.
Councillor Sharma.
Councillor Lewis, I agree with Councillor Dodson. I've looked at this area through iView, and we all heard the detailed presentation. So I'd like to move that we install the stop signs at Edmund and Profaniak. And I do concur in the number 2. We leave it as is, though. Concur in public service. So I'd like to move that forward.
Okay. Can I just ask a couple more questions, or are we done the
questions? Well, there is a motion on the table, but yes, you can still ask questions.
Okay. Yeah. So how long has the Profaniak one been in existence? Has it been there for, has the intersection been there for a year?
You know, actually, Councillor Wyatt would probably know that answer better than I do.
We'd have to suspend.
We have to suspend. Okay. Yeah. All right. Okay.
I don't know that in detail.
Okay. All right.
I heard the presentation. I think we saw the diagrams, and I'm feeling comfortable with this. Mm-hmm. Agree with you, Councillor Dobson.
Yep, I agree. The number of complaints Councillor Wyatt had from the neighbors in the area, and for that particular intersection, because it's a boulevard, and they've got a rather different intersection that they requested a 4-way stop sign, and just because it doesn't meet the warrant doesn't necessarily mean that you can't put stop signs there. It's a great recommendation to meet the warrant amounts, but it's not necessarily the only rules we follow.
The committee has the jurisdiction, certainly not to not to concur with the recommendation, the committee and the city then takes on the responsibility legally for...
So maybe you could elaborate on that. I mean, I'm not an engineer. I've been a huge advocate of pedestrians and active transportation for 12, 15 years, so I'm all for the pedestrian. But I feel very uncomfortable making a decision. I'm not an engineer. I don't think any of us at this table are engineers, and these are professional opinions. And what is the liability? I mean, I know you're not a lawyer. What sort of liability when we make a decision, when we as elected officials make a decision on something like this, on an intersection, that engineers have, I realize there's challenges with engineers too. I mean, there's no system is perfect, but we're trying to operate under a system that we take in expert advice and guidance. And what sort of liability is the subcity open to?
Well, if I can just step back, in terms of the engineering profession, the engineers are held to standards and held accountable through the act that governs their professional behavior, and certainly the profession holds us accountable if there was some sort of negligence in the decisions and the recommendations that we made. So our folks take these responsibilities very very seriously. In terms of if there is a situation where it was recommended that either for or against by the administration, by the engineering staff, and this committee overrules, for lack of a better term, that and goes in a different way. If there was an incident at that location and it can be shown that it's a result of doing something different than what was recommended, typically the city would settle.
Pardon me?
The city would just settle because we have no defense.
Mm-hmm. So that's the decision we're making. So I'm not comfortable. I'm not comfortable supporting this. This actually is something that over the years I've come to see decisions that have been made in the city that have been political decisions versus engineering decisions. Not saying all engineering decisions are right, but I'm not an engineer, and I'm not comfortable supporting a decision that an engineer has made a recommendation not to do.
Can I just say something?
Mm-hmm.
There have been situations, Brad, where the administration's recommended something, we've put it in, and that hasn't been the best option either, and then we've moved to something else, correct? Because that was just recently, I can think of some in Lawrence Elk or West Caledonia Community
mm-hmm.
Committee area,
mm-hmm.
and it has been a traffic hazard. We thought it was a good thing, it wasn't the best thing for the community, and the councillor was actually saying something different,
mm-hmm.
and we went to that
mm-hmm.
Decision, and I've seen that. Is that true?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know the specific instance that you're referring to.
It might do with traffic or speed issues. King Edward, for example, there were some stop sign issues on Leela in my ward in the new development. So I've seen this in my term where it has worked out really well from the community because we hear from the residents and we're bringing the issues here. And the warrant is also a period of time when we do that study.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know, and like I said, because I have been involved in pedestrian work and cycling work for 14 years and have worked very closely with administration, more as the advocate on the other side of the table, trying to get things better for pedestrians, crosswalks and such, and have come to really learn and understand there is definitely a process and there's absolutely values in the engineering work that they do. So for me, for now, I'm not comfortable with supporting this.
Could I mention something? Now, if the warrant suggested that we put in stop signs and we didn't concur with that, then of course I can see where the city would be held somewhat responsible because the engineer said that we should have a stop sign and we disagreed with it. But putting a stop sign where it doesn't necessarily warrant it, I don't understand how that could pose a risk for the city because it actually is slowing it down. It's more and less, that would be more safe.
Depends what you're looking at. Whenever you change the traffic control in an intersection, you change the dynamic of the traffic and the interaction between pedestrians and other motorists' expectations that someone is going to stop because there's a new stop sign there. It's a very complicated thing, and there is a lot of judgment that has to be made. And you know, just in terms of us bringing a recommendation forward, that's our best advice. Obviously, it's the wisdom of any committee of council to if they choose, because you have other things that you need to consider, and certainly we have the greatest respect and understanding of that. It's a very complicated dynamic, obviously, and we're here to serve. Whatever the decision of the committee is, we're fine with that. But it does change the dynamic of an intersection, whether it was warranted or not warranted. Historically, four-way stops have been put in place as traffic calming.
Yeah.
And we've had a great deal of problems with that, where you end up with traffic speeding in between the stop signs as a result, or rolling through the intersections, those kinds of things. And I'm not suggesting that's the situation. In fact, I don't think it is. It's a situation where the warrant wasn't met, and it's our recommendation that it's not warranted. But of course, the wisdom of this committee rules.
And of course, even if it was warranted, there's still the fact that we're putting in a new stop sign, and of course, people aren't used to it. Even if it was warranted or unwarranted, there's still going to be that same risk.
Whenever we put in a new traffic control device, we put advanced signing in, if there's a new intersection.
But regardless, it's the same risk, whether it's warranted or unwarranted.
The movement of traffic on our streets is an inherently complicated thing. You have a lot of people every day that have to make the right series of judgments that they're driving.
Choices, yeah.
And the choices that pedestrians make as well. And the goal is for us collectively to make sure that we're doing everything as safe as possible, and I know that's what we're all trying to do.
Councillor Sharma and then Councillor Gilroy.
If we move forward with putting it in today, are we able to review it in a period of 1 year and look at the warrant again because it was so close? And because, again, there are other examples in my community committee where it was put up and then it wasn't the best, or vice versa. Like maybe we can keep our eye on this and review it again within a 1 year period or something.
Yeah, and we do. We're constantly keeping an eye on everything that we're responsible for out there. Interestingly, installation of all-way stop control has sometimes resulted in, before we ever are drawn into a further discussion on it, it will come through the ward councillor or 311 where people are unhappy about it, and that will cause us to go back and look at it, where you may be inducing long lineups on a stretch of roadway that in the past was free flow. So again, it's a very complicated issue. And the warrant system in our analysis of the collision history and the engineering judgment results in the best advice that we can get.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Councillor Gilroy.
How long is the study? Is it just 1 8-hour period, or is it over a week stretch, or is it just 1 8-hour period that you study this?
Typically, we will go out for a day. We'll gather information on either side, and then we focus on the highest 8-hour period.
Okay. So, I mean, it's so close that I just feel. I mean, if you would have done this on a Saturday afternoon, that area is really growing, and the numbers are very close. So, I'm comfortable.
Okay. Okay. So, can I have a recorded my.
Yeah,
I can. Sure, yeah.
I'm just not comfortable with this. Sorry. I mean, I I'm a huge advocate for pedestrians and cyclists, and I really, really have to rely on what the engineers are putting forward and the risk and the liability that the city is exposed to. And I'm just not comfortable in supporting this.
If I could just, Councillor Sharma, so you're going to concur with recommendation 2, number 1, you're going to not concur with, and you're going to ask to have the stop signs installed at those two locations.
That's right.
Okay, and did you want to request the Winnipeg Public Service to review them after a year as well in your motion? Or is that just discussion?
I was hoping that would make the chairperson feel more comfortable with this. I mean, is that something we'd like?
The warrants are so far on them, I'm just not comfortable with it right now. If the warrants, if they want to, yeah.
So let's add that in there, Madam Clerk?
Okay.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Contrary? Carried.
Okay.
So just so I'm clear, so that was for which locations? That was one and two?
A and B.
Yeah.
A and B.
So A and B.
One and two?
One A and one B.
Two is fine, the way you have it.
Two is fine. They're leaving two, they're concurring with your recommendation number two.
Oh, okay.
So there's two recommendations, recommendation one, A and B.
Okay. Okay, gotcha.
All righty. Okay, number six, item number six. Moving on. Item number six, Prairie Grove Traffic Assessment. Okay, this is pretty straightforward. I have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Yeah, we would, ideally, we'd like to get clear of winter with these because, you don't get a good sense of normal weather driving speeds. So, I think, do we have a meeting in July?
No.
Okay, so we'll bring back for the June meeting because I don't want to go over and into the fall.
The June meeting is at the end of June, June 23rd.
We can come back for the June meeting. We should be able to get the data. Hopefully the roads will be thawed out by then.
Okay, all right. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Item number seven. Proposed no parking notification for the fall and spring streets cleaning schedule. Now, this, if you could elaborate on this a bit, because there's a process underway. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, the Winnipeg Parking Authority has initiated a project. What they're looking to do is essentially consolidate into a parking bylaw. There are various sort of standalone bylaws that impact various types of parking conditions. And one of them has to do with the type of parking we're talking about here, or no parking, under the traffic bylaw. So what we're saying in this report is that we concur and certainly with the motion and that the signs be put out 24 hours in advance. We'll give it actually operationally works better as well. So I think there's a win-win there. The problem for us is that the existing bylaw, the way it's worded, does not allow us to do that. So what we're suggesting is that rather than focusing on only this part of a change in the bylaw and consuming the time and resources of our legal folks to do that, that we roll it into the changes that are coming, the consolidation of this other project into a parking bylaw, and then institute it after that.
Is there a way, like, I mean, for the spring cleanup, there's nothing worse than parking your car and having it towed. So is there a way, so if we lay it over, you'll have time between now and the next, I guess, till the next meeting? So the next RPW meeting to find out if there's a way that we can post the signs even though the bylaw process hasn't?
We've looked into it already and we're confident that it would not be appropriate within the existing bylaw to make that change. We can look into it further.
Okay, so we'll lay it over.
So when will it come back so we know?
Yeah.
You want
60 days would take us, I guess, into April. No, it's really, I think, going to be a fairly quick sort of yes or no official opinion from our legal folks. So we'll do that and we'll come back to the next meeting.
In the next, in 30 days?
Yeah.
Okay, super. Excellent, okay. Okay, Councillor Guillory, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay, item number eight. Can you speak to this, Mr. Satcher? And then I have also a motion I want to bring forward. Okay, this is really, with our new increases in funding for streets and roads, mm-hmm. this is really important, so.
It is very important. You know, with the increase in funding that we're seeing to the roads, which is a very good thing, there's also the additional workload on the entire system, whether it's the contractors being able to respond to the tenders, our design that's done, which in our system is primarily done with consultants, our own staff, you know, it takes time to ramp up the number of staff so that they can actually manage the consultants and the contractors. So there's a lot that needs to happen with the increases. And there's a lot of good information identified here, and certainly all things that we can look at. The one issue under 2C is something that with the increased funding that the province is seeing and the amount of work that they're having to do, some of it related to the loss of bridge structures as a result of flooding, just the general condition of highways, they don't have additional capacity within the province, and we work quite closely with them on a number of issues, both formally and informally. We have staff that work on committees with not only the provincial highways folks, but across Canada as part of the Transportation Association of Canada's committee works. So we get to sample what others are doing all across the country, and we do have staff that spend a lot of time with their counterparts at the province looking at things and how we could do things differently. They have a different setup and in terms of how they deliver their projects. They do have in-house capacity, far more than we do, but they are now having to look at consultants to help with their workload. So things are changing for them, and right now that the capacity internally to even have that discussion would be for naught simply because it's not there. But certainly, there's a lot of good information that can come from looking at these types of things. It's just at this time a working group with the province to look at roads and bridge projects wouldn't bear the fruit that it might have under different circumstances. Certainly the industry as well, the heavy construction industry would also be very valuable in helping to look at ways to improve the processes. They're a key player in making that happen.
So do we have any questions? Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Satcher on this? I'd like to receive it as information and then expand on it with a motion that if someone could take the chair, I could bring forward.
So you're putting forward a motion in place of this?
To receive this as information, because we've got a working group with the province of Manitoba right now underway, but it's really important that the city get their, you know, we saw the province come out early with their tenders. They came out really early in the game in February, and it's really important as we go forward with our percentage increase for our roads that we've received the funding for, that we get our tenders out earlier, and I'd like to sort of get a process underway to look at how we can do that better than what we've been doing. I've sat through budget presentations before, and on some years, it's considerable savings that I've seen reflected. Considerable savings when we get it up the door earlier, when we get the tenders up the door earlier. So
there's no motion on the table right now, Councillor, so if you wanted to bring your new business item first.
Should I bring my new, should
or
I bring
is that new business at the end, or are we suspending the rules to
you
deal with it now because it's to do with this?
Mm-hmm. It's to do with this, so I thought I'd do it at the same time.
So we're receiving, you're proposing we receive this
information.
This
is information.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So should we, do I suspend the rules?
Are you bringing your new motion
I'm bringing my new
now?
Motion forward now.
Yeah, so.
Okay, so.
Suspension of the rules from somebody to bring a new
I'll
business
move.
Item.
Yeah. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay, so this is the motion I'd like to bring forward. Whereas the city's capital budget for road infrastructure has been increasing year over year. And whereas early project designs and tendering and timely contract awards facilitate the best use of available funds and the most efficient use of the available construction season. And whereas efficient project procurement and delivery improves labor productivity, supply logistics, and program management. And whereas improved project scheduling to allow the majority of tendering to occur between November and March will allow timely construction startups in the spring and will help reduce the impact of potential construction inflation. Therefore, be it resolved that the public service be directed to participate in the creation of a task force with representatives from the City of Winnipeg and Manitoba Heavy Construction Association, and to report back within 120 days with recommendations for the improvement of project scheduling, engineering consultant procurement, early tendering and timely contract awards. So in essence, it's not going to happen for this season, but we start the process now, and we work through it, and we get them out the door earlier for next year.
You're essentially adding the Heavy Construction Association?
Yes, yes. Okay, so.
Yep. Well, Councillor Sharma is chair.
Mm-hmm. Yep, yep.
Okay.
Any questions?
Any questions or comments?
Okay. Nope, makes total sense.
Yeah.
The sooner you get it out there, the better chance you have to be the first person on the block to get the deal.
You're asking the administration to come back in 120 days.
Right, right. And to work with the Heavy Construction Association and work together to figure out how we can get this out the door earlier, the tenders out the door earlier.
All in favor?
Okay.
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Okay.
Back to you, Madam Chair.
I have a motion.
Oh, sorry, motion. Got it. Okay.
Did we already put the number 8 as information?
No, okay. you haven't put a motion for number 8 yet.
Okay.
Madam Clerk, could I get a copy of that motion? I didn't have one.
I can get you one. Got
okay.
it. Sorry.
Sorry. Okay. So then we'll put forward a could someone move to receive this as information? Could someone move that item number?
Item 8.
Yeah,
8 is received as information. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
You already did that, yeah.
No.
No, we didn't.
No. We didn't have a motion for item 8.
Oh. Just to put it on
it's
as
gone.
Information.
It's on information.
Okay.
Yeah, she said aye.
Okay. Process. We're getting our process together here. Okay. All right. Item number 9, south of Aldgate Road, recreational opportunities. We heard Councillor Lard speak to this. I'm very familiar with this.
It's a really good idea, Madam Chair. Mm-hmm. So to look at temporary use.
Yeah, it's temporary. It's temporary, but
green space. Sure, go for it.
It's a big green space. I don't know if it's possible. I don't know if it's if we even have the budget for it. But you know what? If administration could look at it, we'd really be pleased. Okay. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Item number 10. Traffic calming measures, Lilac Street and Dorchester Avenue. Okay, this is great. Again, more calming for pedestrians. I'm familiar with this. I'm very familiar with traffic circles and ball bouts. I don't know. Does anyone have any questions of Mr. Satcher on this one? Maybe did you want to make any comments on this?
Well, just that
in the recommendations, we're first saying that that we wouldn't do a wouldn't recommend a traffic calming circle or raised intersection that they be constructed at this time, but that the curb bump outs on Lilac be considered in future traffic engineering improvement program budget planning. So just for information, it would be our intention to put it forward for 2016.
For 2016.
Right. So for the next budget, capital budget.
For the next capital budget, okay. Okay. All right. I don't see much in here though in the report. I just wanted to comment on that and about actually pedestrians themselves. I mean, this is a traffic, they're wanting to slow down traffic. I guess it's just a little nuance in the report, you know?
One of the, traffic calming is obviously about a number of things. One of it is to discourage the volumes that we're using that route. You know, shortcutting is a huge problem in neighborhoods. And by default, make it safer, not only for pedestrians, but certainly the residents who use the roads every day to and from their residences. Certainly pedestrians are included in the well-being that comes out of these kind of changes. But the exercise of calming traffic is about discouraging road users from using a road that it wasn't intended to be used as. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And also lowering the average speeds that that they will be traveling for those who still choose to go that way. Mm-hmm. And our experience has been that can be quite effective.
But it's a combination though. It is for calming traffic and also for the safety of pedestrians.
Absolutely. Every street is a combination of having traffic on the roadway move safely, but at the same time, accommodating pedestrians safely, all the road users, and it all types of traffic, whether it's young kids to elderly, folks who may have various disabilities, and we do a lot of different things in this city in that regard, and certainly we've seen success with these types of changes in the past.
Yeah, and so it's just more of a little comment that maybe we could write in also that it's
sure.
For pedestrians going forward. I think Councilor Dawson had a question first.
No, I'm good.
Oh, you're good?
Yeah,
okay.
He answered it.
Councilor.
I have a question as a new councillor. When you view this, do you look at also to bike trafficking? Because some of the issues with the raised intersection, the jot outs of the sidewalks.
The bump outs. Yes.
Yeah, the bump outs. Really, you know, it really can also to the bike pedestrian, bike people riding bikes, it's kind of dangerous. So I was wondering if that's something that you guys, when you guys measure this, if you look at that. Just in this area in particular, a lot of people do ride their bikes as well. And just was wondering if that's part of the study or?
Yeah, the width of the throat in between the bump outs allows for safe passage of a motorized vehicle and a cyclist. I mean, the law requires the cyclist to travel as close to the curb as possible. So we take into account the fact that there could be a cyclist there at the same time as the vehicle. So it's taken into account.
Any other questions on this one?
No, actually, it looks pretty good. The drawing is very nice.
Okay. Super. All right. Can I have someone move this, please?
No. He wants it on next year's budget. So do we approve it as it?
See the second bullet there, that it be considered in future traffic engineering improvement budget planning. So they will put that into their process of prioritizing and budget planning for next year. It won't be in this year's budget, and
okay.
That's basically, as I understand it, that's what that sentence
all
means.
Right.
So
then I'm fine with that.
Yeah. Okay.
So you're moving that, Councilor?
Yeah. I'll
yeah.
Move that,
you're gonna move it. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried. All right. And now I'd like to ask someone to consent agenda and adjournment.
Oh, here we go.
We're done.
So
okay.
We're
all right. All in favor? Carried.
Well, that's it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, committee. Thank you.
the third committee here.
Sorry about stop signs.
Don't apologize.
One of them, there's a park on the other side, and I'm looking at it, and I'm just doing the eye view and looking down.